Hey guys, Bugcat7 here. Okay, it is Thursday, June 20th, 2019, and I want to thank you for visiting the Stonewall Research channel here on YouTube. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. And if you would kindly hit the like button, guys, that would be great. All right, well, before I even begin, I want to give a shout out to Phil at the Ancient Alternative View. He's going into hospital to have his Rolls-Royce engine tuned up, and we wish him all the best. Speedy recovery, and please do get back soon, Phil. We want to hear from you. All right, and go over to Phil's channel. He just did a video on Longyu caves in China, which is just fascinating. You're going to want to see that. All right, well, I hope to get through this for you guys, but, you know, I have this very interesting site here, and even mainstream doesn't really know the purpose of it. They have a sort of estimated time period, but I think it's all baloney anyway. And they have a BS side to this whole thing that really gets deep. And here's where I try to earn my stripes, you know, as a researcher, try to anyway. And go way deep, man. That's, you know, maybe a cut above some other researchers on some other channels, you know. But I know from the guys I do know, and, you know, this takes time. It's taken me days of research to get to the bottom of this and to read some very scholarly reports, etc. Which, you know, again, you got to go way deep, guys, and look at the very obscure data that, you know, you can get out of these things. So, any case, the site is also interesting to me because it relates to my research in Connecticut, in the very rural Connecticut, in the Green Mountain chain there, very close to the Housatonic River, which is a very long river, 149-mile-long river that exits out into the Long Island Sound, just with, you know, lots and lots of water, other than the Connecticut River. So many settlement sites were around these river areas, and this was one of them. In Mallory there, and there are some construction elements there to the wall systems there, and also the earthworks, and apparently would appear to be either moats or some sort of rudimentary canals or something like that in these areas that just so similar, it's uncanny. And I was reading Charles C. Mann's book today, 1491, about the mound builders, and they showed Adena mounds out in eastern Pennsylvania. So, and we don't know about the other ones that could have been in the Northeast. Most of them were destroyed, as reported by Jim Vieira. And, you know, a lot of the archaeological sites, I report about it in the book from the Library of Congress by Rutenberg on the tribes of the Hudson's Valley, where they were Dutch, were already defacing the cliffs of the Hudson's Valley, of the carvings in there. So, you know, we can't ever see those because they're gone. But I think some of them went out to Brighton Beach, and if they are truly off the cliff basin from Hudson's Valley there, that's very interesting. But in any case, let's get to this site over here, and I'll relate it back to my research if I can in some of the videos that I've done to show you how similar these things are. It's just very uncanny. So this is called the Old Stone Fort in Tennessee. It's near the Pinson Mounds near Jackson, okay? So they talk about the Hope Well and the Adena being in these areas and some from some of those time periods in the Paleo Indian stages, what they call the Middle Woodland period, where they often do not find skeletons. I did research on New York State, William A. Ritchie. They dug up a bunch of these places. They could never find a skeleton. No skeletons of any Paleo Indians have ever been found from the earliest stage. And then in the in-between stages, the Middle Woodland one and the Woodland ones being some of them, they didn't find any skeletal remains either, but they often found large artifacts in these mounds that were too big for what they believed, well, somebody of average size, Native American, could handle, okay? So it's just very odd that in every one of these burials, the items they found were of uniform size. So that's very curious there, that they know exactly how big they're going to be in the afterlife. So keep that in mind. That just doesn't make a lot of sense. They haven't found any skeletons, so put two and two together. They just don't want to say some things, the anti-religion people or whatever. Whoever, you know, whatever weirdos they are. So Old Stone Fort in Tennessee. The Old Stone Fort is a prehistoric Native American structure located in Corby County, Tennessee, in the southeastern United States. The structure was most likely built between 80 and 550 AD. Well, that's an awful long stretch of time there to take an estimate from, and they do a radiocarbon dating, whatever. They don't know. It's nonsense. During the Middle Woodland period, which I just told you, in a lot of these cases, they never find any skeletal remains. What were the morphology and phenotype of these people? They don't know. And they don't know what this is, site is for. But I'm going to tell you from my standpoint, and I will inject my two cents from an engineering standpoint, industrial engineering, industrial design. You have to look at it from these things. They say ceremonial, but it's multiple use. Or, you know, dual, simultaneous uses of ceremony and business are the same thing. It is the most complex hilltop enclosure found in the South. It was likely used for ceremonial purpose rather than defense. Well, they're not high enough walls, that's why. And they're rounded at this point, they say. But they could have been rounded and mound-like since then, like the ones I found at Mallory. Either way, they're both there. The structure is now part of the Old Stone Fort State Archaeological Park, one of two archaeological parks in Tennessee, the other being at Pinson Mounds near Jackson. The site is listed on the National Register of Historic Places. Okay, so it's a historic place. And here's a map, an old map from 1876. Okay, Little Duck River and the Duck River, and this is on this peninsula. It's just so very interesting to me, the way this thing looks almost like an effigy head, turtle head, serpent head, but the whole thing is it's an enclosure, and here's just this one entrance, which is an L-shaped entrance here. Okay, it seems like you have to funnel people through this. Seems like a security measure in a way. Or in a way where they would have to keep track of things. You see what I'm saying? From an industrial design point of view, and you have the Hopewell and the Dina and the Hopewell Procurement Network, which I mentioned in one of my videos. I do a whole video on the Hopewell Procurement Network, okay, from coast to coast, procuring goods, okay? This could be a marketplace. This could be a trading area. Highly likely that it's more likely that than what they say it is. That's what I say. Okay, not so much a ceremonial area, but a place of trade among the Hopewell area. And listen to what they say, because there's trail networks, highway networks. You know, you got to think about it this way. The Hopewell had highway networks going across this country to procure their items for their people. All right? So let's look at this. I'm not going to go with a geographic setting, but it is interesting. The site is 50 acres. The walled area structure encompasses approximately 50 acres. Okay? It's pretty big. Pretty huge. And it must have taken a tremendous effort to build this 4 to 6 foot high stone and earthen wall area that's thousands of feet long. Okay, so it's saying about how millwrights were in that area in history, and that's where the plot thickens. I want to get to it because otherwise you're going to run out of video time here. Okay, but I got to read some of it to you here. So, you know, they're just saying there was 19th century mills built there. There seems to be no evidence of them there except in one location on this peninsula here that they're attributing to, and I smell a rat. I smell a BS story there, and we'll see why soon. Okay, the walls of the Old Stone Fort consist of a stone and earthwork, and are on average approximately 4 to 6 feet high. The walls originally consisted of an inner and outer layer of crudely stacked rocks and slabs with gravel and earthen fill in between. Over the centuries, the earthen fill had spilled over the rock layers, giving the walls their current mound-like appearance. Very curious there, I found very similar walls up in Mallory, in the adjacent part to the Mallory Trail up in rural Connecticut in the mountains there. The walls can be divided into roughly three sections, with two sections running roughly parallel to Duck and Little Duck Rivers, and a third section running parallel to the southern rim of the peninsula. The sections paralleling the rivers gradually move inward away from their respective rivers and approach one another in a pincer-like formation at the northeastern half of the peninsula. Here, both walls terminate just before converging, allowing for a small entrance, okay, to monitor who's going in and out, I say. Two ancient pedestal mounds, one 35 feet in diameter and the other 48 feet in diameter, located on either side of the structure's entrance. The entrance continues through a 120-foot L-shaped corridor, which opens into the structure's interior to channel people in there. Okay? That L-shaped corridor, 120-foot. But still, because large amounts of goods and resources were coming in and out of there, not ceremonies going on there, okay? Ignore that. They don't know. I know. I've been researching this for 5 years, 6 years now, and I wouldn't consider myself an expert, but certainly in a stone walls of New York and New England, I have a lot of experience. On site, in person, in the field experience. Okay, we'll look at that. The fort's northwestern walls follows the Duck River are approximately 1,394 feet, 425 meters long, and the southeastern walls following the Little Duck are approximately 1,094 feet, 333 meters in length. The southern walls, which are basically straight with the exception of an area where the ridge bulges outward, are 2,116 feet, 645 meters long. So it's huge sections of wall there. It's just immense and a tremendous amount of work to do that. You've got to realize that. I hope you do. Large open sections are found between both the southern wall and the northwestern wall and the southern wall and the southeastern wall. These areas were probably left open due to the fact that they overlook steep bluffs carved out by the Duck and Little Duck Rivers, whose waters probably perform the same function as the mounds. A substantial ditch known as the moat parallels the southern wall at the base of the ridge. This ditch is a natural defense and is actually an abandoned river channel. However, it is not known if this channel was artificially kept open in prehistory. Interesting statement there by them. It was artificially kept open in prehistory, means that they were managing it somehow for some purpose, okay? And it just found similar stuff up in Maui. Let's look at that for a second, if I can get it here. It's still here. Okay. So, these are earthworks at Maui that your buddy, BudCat7, is here showing you. All right, and there's this causeway, and here's the entrance off the trail to the causeway here that I'm showing in this video here. I don't know if you can see it, but, and there's a stone, there's two moat-like areas. This is one of them. I'm showing the causeway here. This is it. It's like a earthen platform with an excavated side that's like a moat on that side, and another one in front of it here where a stone wall just runs the length of it inside the moat with the earthen causeway in the background that leads down to this water area, this water hole area, which is either, you know, snow melt off that last all summer. This one lasts all summer, but not many of them do, with some boulders and stone that are always placed in by these things. A pile of them are always placed by these things, and it looks like some stonework in a corner here. But that led me to an area that seemed older and more, you know, megalithic in size, and that's where I saw these mound-like stone walls. Here at this site adjacent to Mallory here, and let's see if I can get him here. And here I'm coming up to it. It's on the right of me and the left. They had opened this area to put this bench area here. So here's like the mound-like stone wall areas, and you can see right here. This is earth-covered stone here. Large stone down for some length, you know, maybe 100 feet or so here, and then on the other side as well, with this marshy area in here, which could have been filled with water at one time. This is just past the area that I just showed you, in the other video. So you can see I come down into the trailer area, and there's these odd piles of huge stone. And you can see this walled area here. It's about 5 to 6 feet high, goes all the way down the trail here, and it's just covered with earth. So, and this is near the Housatonic River, which is a major river, is nearby. So I go further down, you can see earthen covered stone wall construction all down here. Not natural. Clearly not natural. So, in any case, that's what I found there at Mallory, and just it's so similar to what they're describing at this site. The moats, the earthen causeway, the wall, the earthen covered stone walls. Okay, so here's where it gets thick, and here's where I think the BS story gets deep, and they don't know about this when you, excuse me, when you get down to the nitty-gritty and do the research into these very scholarly articles on these things, you can see where they're just not telling the truth here, but they're putting it in here as if it was fact, and it's not. And here's where Budcat here earns his stripes as a researcher, I hope. Okay, so they talk about this well-worn trail traverse the Cumberland Plateau, connecting one now Middle Tennessee with Georgia and northern Alabama. One trail passed near the old stone fort, closely following now what is U.S. 41. The ancient structure was no doubt an important landmark to early travelers in the Middle Tennessee area, okay? So this is part of that Hopewell procurement. All those trails, those, you know, the trails go back, the Hopewell and the Edina being the oldest of the settlement areas there, they go back to those times. This is part of the procurement network, okay? And if this site is indeed from the time period they suggest, which could be any time, they don't have that right, okay? That area was a trading area. By the way, it's designed with a single opening, okay, like that, to monitor what was going on in there. You understand? Everybody was on the honor system. Nobody was screwing around there. You understand? That's people thought in those terms back then. They always say ceremonial, like these people were in a constant state of, you know, worship. It's not the case at all. This is what much of this stone wall building is all about. And it could very well be a combination of the two. In however sense we can imagine. Right? So, in any case, let me get to this because I want to get to the deep stuff here. So, they talk about this. These mills being built around it, these older mills or whatever. However, there's no remains of any of those mills, but they talk about this W.S. Whitman paper mill, who was a real guy who had mills in near Nashville and White Creek, but somehow he acquired this property. He may have owned it or whatever, but and they say he built the mill, but there's no evidence of that mill there, but and his name is spelt wrong. It's not Whitman, it's Whiteman. And I can't help thinking that these are just not, you know, unhappy coincidences or whatever. Just, his name is Whiteman, not Whitman. Okay, as Wikipedia reports it here to be. Okay, not Whitman, Whiteman. Okay, so it burnt down. It was destroyed by Union troops, okay? This is the mill that was there supposedly in 1852. And in 1862, he built a powder factory. So he was building for Confederate Confederacy. He was supplying them with gunpowder or whatever he's doing in this mill there or whatever. And that's where it gets all murky. And that's why there's a lot of research done into this Whiteman guy. He's not Whitman, as Wikipedia says here. So But this is what caught my interest, and the BS detector just went off. In 1879, that's a pretty late date in the 19th century, the Stone Fort Paper Company built a large mill near Big Falls on the Duck River. The mill supplied paper to the newspapers throughout the Southeast, including Nashville Banner and Atlanta Constitution, until the early 20th century. Okay? The mill's foundations are on the bluffs overlooking the Big Falls and can be accessed via the old Stone Fort Loop Trail. So I'm sure the trail is nice there. I'd love to go. The property can... Okay, so I'm not even going to read that, okay? But this, the Stone Fort Paper Company, which was the mill that was built in this Little Falls area, okay? Big Falls area, okay? Which is on the peninsula there. And here's the picture of it right here. All right. And I'm looking at this picture and I'm saying, wait a second, being a student of engineering and architecture and everything, and this was built in 1879, this looks way too crude for a building that was built. And allegedly, you know, I read the other scholarly articles on it, and, you know, apparently it was financed by financiers in Chicago, et cetera, et cetera. So let's just quickly look at buildings built, okay, and these are important buildings. These are, you know, old buildings built in that time period, okay, in the 19th century, historic buildings from that time period, okay. And here's the Delaware Building in Chicago, built in 1872, where all those financiers' money was coming from, okay. You see the level of architecture and construction in this building right over here, okay, and they're supplying the big box, okay, for this thing, right? Okay, and here's some other pictures of it if I got for you, if I can show it to you. Oh, no, not that one. That's something altogether different. Okay, so let me see if I can get these pictures up here for you. Real quick, because I want to show you the construction style here, which appears to be dry laid stone with no mortar. I mean, you're saying this was financed, this is a serious undertaking. Supposedly a large mill was constructed here, and this is the level of architecture and building method for the foundation of this large mill that was supposedly built there, the Stone Fort Paper Mill, in 1872. I don't think so. And you see, this is a baser part of it. All right. There doesn't appear to be any mortar in it. It appears to be dry laid stone. If they did have mortar in it, I mean, you can look at it. It looks like it may, but that's similar to the sites that I found in Mallory there. Okay. Of this mill, maybe, and see if I can get it up here quick, so I got to get to the real meat of this, the BS story here. Okay, I'm showing this blown up dam here in Mallory, and I'm trying to show you it here. All right, so here's part of it here, and there was some repair work there, but behind it, it's all dry laid stone. Okay. All dry laid stone, no mortar, right? See if I get to where I'm showing it here. All right, so it's a similar style of construction, whatever, but you know, this dam is supposedly like ancient dam. And I don't think it had anything to do with the settlers or anything like that, so. In any case, just a similar thing there, and also a mill you see behind me there. Very primitive. Very primitive. And also this what I thought was maybe a mill, but I had my doubts, but you see this incredible thing there that I found in New Milford, Connecticut. All right, see the building style? Alright, so if you haven't seen those videos, please go to my channel, look at my Mallory playlist. I gotta get to this, guys, because this is where the whole thing breaks down on this very odd construction here that doesn't appear to be a foundation. And the outside walls, it seems to be subterranean. The outside walls are covered with earth up to the outside. It's only the inside here. They say it's a foundation, but I don't think so. Or maybe for something else. Because the story doesn't jive up. And here's a scholarly article by this Hobart Aiken. The thesis submitted in partial fulfillment of the requirements for the degree of Master of Arts in Public History. So let's just read something real quick from here. Because I got a couple other things to show you. 21. This is where it got deep, and this is where I just confirmed the whole thing's a BS story, okay? For the purpose of this work, the analysis tracks the beginning of the area in chronological order, starting with the old stone fort paper mills under the direction of W.S. Whiteman and his sons, okay? And this county in Tennessee was not noted for their kindly attitude towards, people of color, okay? You'd hardly believe that they were kindly to Indians, so why not sort of erase this history from them, okay? Then the Higginson firm, and finally Francis H. Wooten's operations on the site. Examining the ways different people have used the old stone fort provides greater understanding of the property's development and enriches the understanding of its continued relevance in local and regional history. Currently, a small sign presents a short narrative about the mills and their significance to local and regional development. It pairs this text with a small map locating the rag mill and the wood pulp mills along the river's edge, which are not on the peninsula. Okay. Together, the map and the text illustrate the size of the industrial complex amid the mounds. However, the industrial history is not as developed as it could be. One sign explains the presence of the industrial site and the mills as an episode in the site's history, unrelated to the prehistoric past. This connects the park to the 19th century history, but it fails to illuminate the larger picture of landscape alteration over time. The local area's history also lacks, get this, the local area's history also lacks detailed accounts of the human drama played out during these periods. In fact, there never has been a formal history of the Old Stone Fort Paper Company or even the park itself. Because this story is as important as the archaeological site, the founding of the park, this work attempts to provide a narrative of the site's industrial history and offer suggestions for integrating the narrative into central interpretive themes of the park. Okay, so this guy is basically starting with a preconceived notion about it, and you know what he's trying to do is make it fit in there instead of letting the evidence speak for itself. As again, do you see the